All right, so welcome to our closing keynote of our advanced R session. So I'm really excited to introduce you to Gabriel Becker, who is a statistical computing researcher who has, I think, worn a number of different hats. He has been a scientist at Genentech. He has had close collaboration with R Core and has designed and contributed a couple of the more recent language features. But I think his primary interest and what he'll be talking to us about today is reproducibility, which I'm really excited about. We've had a lot of hands-on, nitty-gritty R stuff, but I think one of the core reasons, as Olga described earlier, one of the core reasons we use R is because we want to have this reproducible workflow. We want other people to be able to reproduce our results, our statistical methods, our conclusions, our figures, everything. So I'm really happy to hear what Gabriel has to say for us about reproducibility. Thank you.
Great. Thanks for the introduction. So as she said, I am Gabe. If you're on Twitter, you can find me at GroundwalkerGNB, where I tweet pretty much exclusively about R and reproducibility and things like that. And then my GitHub, which you may already know because I sent out the link to the slides, which are on my GitHub page, is GM Becker. So just first we'll go through a little bit of intro. Kylie covered a lot of this, but just to reiterate again so that I don't skip things, I'm Gabe Becker. Those are my Twitter and GitHub. What I do, as Kylie said, I do research into reproducibility and a number of surrounding related issues, which you guys will be hearing quite a bit more about over the course of this talk. And then the second thing that I like to do is contribute to the R language itself. I do note that I am not a member of R Core, although I do collaborate pretty closely with a couple different members on that team. And who I was, so normally I'm not the type of person to, you know, dwell on the past, but I was a scientist at Genentech up until late last year, and the reason that I'm bringing that up is that some of the content in this talk was created by me while I was at Genentech, but it is copyright Genentech. All of that will be marked, and it is used with permission. So the basic structure of this talk is that it's going to have two large sections. The first is theory, or mental models, how we may want to think about reproducibility in a way that that a lot of you probably won't have seen before, and why we would want to think about it in this different way. And then in the second part of the talk, we'll talk a little bit about practice. There won't be any code in this talk at all, but I will be talking about practical things that you can do as scientists to improve the work that you're doing in terms of reproducibility and these related issues. So first, let me get out of the way that I really wish that we didn't have to worry about reproducibility at all. It just wasn't even a thing, even though it's like what I love to research and it's what I do, and I've sort of staked my career on doing this. I wish it just was a non-issue. And the reason for that is because lots and lots of problems would already be solved if reproducibility were not something that we have to worry about, right? So we would have cold fusion, so we wouldn't have any sort of energy problems anywhere in the world. We would have personalized cancer treatment that hadn't, you know, been retracted in a cascading scandal, you know, some years ago. We would have a much deeper understanding of how economic systems work if all of the results that we saw in those arenas were actually true. And finally, we would have some pretty good evidence that there may be aliens that can live on in places that look a lot different than Earth. Unfortunately, we are stuck in the real world, and none of the things that I was just talking about are true to the best of our current knowledge. So, reproducibility is a thing. Reproducibility is something that we have to worry about. But it's actually not the point. And I'm going to spend quite a bit of time here talking about what I mean by this. But to get us started, the basics are similar to this quote. So Bill Gates wrote a book, because, of course, Bill Gates wrote a book. Why wouldn't he? And one of the things that he talks about is knowledge management, which is, you know, the control of how information flows through a large, complex corporate structure. You know, how do you make sure certain people know certain things and other people don't know certain things, and when they know them and how they know them and things like this. And the point that he makes in the book is that knowledge management is a means. It's not an end. The point is not to control who knows what and when they know it. The point is the benefits that come from the ability to make sure that certain people know certain things and other people don't know certain things that they're not supposed to know. Right, so this is a means, it's not an end. And what I'm gonna make the case for is that the same is true of reproducibility. Reproducibility is valuable because of what it can buy us, not because of the reproducibility itself. And we'll talk quite a bit more about why that is in a moment. So, to recap, the world would be a much better place if everything was reproducible, and I don't actually really care whether your results are reproducible or not. So this may seem like a contradiction, and if that is upsetting, then you should probably strap in because it's going to be kind of a rough ride, because we're going to talk about a lot of things that seem counterintuitive like this over the course of the talk. So what do we actually really want? So the first thing to note is that results aren't useful to us if we can't use them. Now, I know what you're probably thinking is like, congratulations, like you've said something that's so obvious that no one has probably ever said it before out loud. But the reason that I'm saying this and the reason that I'm emphasizing this is because then we can ask this question, which is, how does actually reproducing a result make it useful specifically to us? And the answer is, it sort of doesn't, right? Again, it buys us these things, and I'm going to talk about what it does buy us in quite a bit. And I'm not making the claim that reproducibility is valueless, but I am making the claim that I think we need to think about its value with more precision than most people do. So what we actually want is results that we can understand and feel confident using. And this is a paraphrase from a paper by Gavish and Donohoe some years ago. And what do we mean by using? We mean incorporating them into our understanding. So if we believe that these results are true, we sort of update our internal model about whatever system that the results are talking about to reflect this new information. And then we will do our own work based on that updated understanding. We want to extend or even directly utilize these results in our own work. So if the result is relevant to us, then we want to be able to actually incorporate it, sometimes quite directly, other times a little bit more indirectly, by extending it ourselves. And then third, and perhaps most importantly, we want to be able to safely talk about these types of things at dinner parties with our scientist friends without looking really bad when it turns out that these results were garbage, right? So what does this ultimately translate to? This means that we need to trust results. So trust, I'm going to claim, is actually the core currency that we actually want to think about when we're assessing whether a result is useful to us or not. But trust is sort of a vague term. It can mean any number of things. And so what we're going to talk about right now is the different ways that we can trust a result once we sort of hear about it or get our hands on it. And so the ways that we can trust our result in increasing levels of both difficulty and value, which unsurprisingly go together, first we can trust that the result was reported correctly. All this really means is that there wasn't some sort of cut and paste error when the person was putting it into their paper, or they didn't put the wrong version of the result out of date in their paper or something like that. So they actually got the result that they then told us that they got. So this is a pretty low bar, but if it's not true, then like nothing else even matters, right? So we have to talk about this first. This is also the easiest one to actually achieve, and we'll talk a little bit more about this later, but this is basically the only thing that really sort of strict reproduction of a result will actually buy you by itself. So next up on the list, if we trust the reporting, then the next thing that we can trust is the implementation. And so what this means is, did the analyst actually do what they think that they did and what they described themselves as doing, having done to us, right? So this means there aren't any bugs that are sort of fatal in their code, right? You can have little bugs, but any bugs that change the result in a fundamental way are not there, or else we don't trust the implementation. This also means that if they did any manual steps, which we really hope that they didn't, they actually did the manual steps that they think that they did. They didn't, you know, miss a column or miss some rows in their Excel spreadsheet or what have you, right? All of these things are situations where they can report correctly, but they can report correctly something that we don't care about because their implementation was wrong anyway. So third, and this is when we start getting some, getting closer to the actual value that we would actually want from a result, is what I'm going to call statistical trust. And so statistical trust is we have trust in the implementation. They did what they think they did, and what they did was a good idea, right? So did they actually make choices that we can agree with and get behind? Because if they didn't, it doesn't really matter if they did what they intended to do if we think that that was a bad idea in the first place, right? So that's actually pretty difficult to achieve, and we'll talk about some ways where you can sort of try to achieve it, but it's not easy. But the crown jewel, the thing that we're all looking for, is what I'm calling scientific trust. And what scientific trust means is that we're actually convinced by the results or the claims that the results are making about underlying systems. And this, in my personal opinion, is actually nearly impossible for an individual result to achieve. What you actually need in order to usually get this is a number of results that we have statistical trust in that corroborate each other or corroborate the claim about the underlying system that they're making. But you could sort of get part of the way there with a really well documented and executed and statistically sound individual result. So this was supposed to be a talk about reproducibility, and you'll notice that I didn't really talk about reproducibility at all when I was sort of giving one of the main theses of this talk. And so how does this actually translate into reproducibility? So it turns out that most of the things that we do to make our results more reproducible map into what you need for these various different types of trust. And the way that they do that, you can see here. So this is a scale of trust, and so this is similar to a number of years ago at this point. Roger Peng published a paper claiming that reproducibility wasn't actually a binary yes or no thing; it was actually a scale, and that was sort of the right way to think about it. So that was quite influential. And he listed a number of different things that sort of get you farther along this scale of reproducibility. And most of those things are basically what I've put here. And the point that I'm trying to make is that those things actually buy you increasing amounts of trust as you increase these. So on the left, you have someone just told you that they got some result. It's like, I got this result, this gene is upregulated, or, you know, this protein is doing some sort of certain thing, or what have you. But they don't really tell you anything about how, or maybe they sort of hand-wavily explain kind of how they got that, but they don't give you any code, and they don't give you the data, and you're like, okay, that's great. Like, congratulations on your thing that I can't verify or really understand at all, right? So then, one small step above that is output. The output is actually guaranteed, so you can actually be sure, more or less, that they did actually get the thing that they said that they got. So that's nice, and that is that's important, but it's still pretty far down in terms and far away from where we want to be. And then, you know, in increasing as they increase value and the trustworthiness of the result, they can provide code, and they can guarantee that code is correct. And there are various ways to do that that I'll talk just a tiny bit about, not a ton. They can provide the data so that you can try to run the code yourself. And then I've got these two boxes that are sort of dashed, which is not something that they can actually do, but it's something that you, as the consumer of the result, are subjectively deciding, which is that you think that their methods were appropriate. So if you have their code, or if they've really, really carefully explained sort of the experimental procedure that they did, then you can decide, like, yeah, that was, you know, that's the right type of thing to do to try to answer this question, or no, they're just off doing something crazy, and I don't really care if, you know, if it's reproducible or not. And then finally, at the very end, you've got scientific trust, which again is what we all want to get to, but it's very hard to get that as a single result. So generally what you're going to have is that that's corroborated by other results, and then you sort of believe that, that these claims are true.
Okay.
Yeah?
I don't know if you're going to get into this, and there's a sense in which it might be orthogonal to things that you want to talk about the most. But I imagine you're familiar with this National Academy of Science report on reproducibility. It's called Statistical Challenges in Assessing and Fostering Reproducibility of Scientific Results.
I have read that. It's been a little while.
It's a couple of years old.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's had the impact that it should have. But I'm thinking about your little triangle down at the bottom called Statistical Trust.
Yeah.
And I just want to read one of the things that initially I thought maybe it was crazy, but I'm not so sure. So there's a bunch of things about statement of task for this group. And the last thing they say is, do we need new conceptual or theoretical frameworks for assessing the strength of evidence from a study?
Yeah.
And the idea that we don't have a conceptual framework for it seems to me, you know, kind of ridiculous. It's what statistics is, right?
Right.
But then when you go through this report, you see this attack on the measures of evidence that we have, like p-value.
Sure.
And it's extremely overwhelming.
Yeah.
And the idea that we understand how that triangle works there is one that's really open to question.
It is. And, you know, I definitely am familiar with the p-value controversy. What that ultimately comes down to is, you know, this decision that the consumers of the results are making is like, is this an appropriate method or not, right? And like, I describe that as subjective in some sense, what I mean by that is, you know, a Bayesian and a frequentist, for example, can disagree about whether, you know, a Bayesian or frequentist analysis is actually a good idea and like provides the evidence that the analyst is claiming that it provides. So in that sense, you know, I agree with them that it would be nice. So, you know, settling statistical questions is a very important thing that I think, you know, I think it's good that we're talking about them. I don't know, you know, I'm not quite as down on p-values necessarily as some, although I do think they need to be used carefully. And that's somewhat related here to what I'm talking about. But what I'm talking about here is it's a little bit more in terms of, do we actually have the information to even make that call at all, right? So like, once we decide whether p-values are a good idea or a bad idea, and if they're a bad idea, what we should do instead, right? Can we then assess how they got that p-value or the thing that's going to replace p-values, and was the analysis that led to that a good idea? Like, you know, were the assumptions that the methods that they used just dramatically violated in a way that sort of invalidates their results as in whole cloth, right? Like, so the sort of meta like, what kind of statistical evidence is even valuable? It comes into this, and like, so basically I think what that would do is that would change the answer to the question of are these methods are appropriate or not. But that answer still actually needs to be assessed, and it requires more information than you often actually have, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Any other questions? So, we're talking about trust, but again, this is allegedly a reproducibility talk. So, let's talk about what does strict reproducibility prove? So, by strict reproducibility, what I mean is you take their data and you run their code on it in their original environment, so the exact software versions that they were using. So, what does that actually give you? Because a lot of people, like, this is what they actually mean when they say that result is reproducible. So what that does is that confirms, in some sense, technically it's more of a beyond reasonable doubt than an actual deductive proof, but it confirms that they got the result that they said they got by applying the code that they provided to the data that they identified in the environment that they specified. And it has the additional benefit of ensuring that you actually have your hands on the artifact so that you can do things to it. But this is actually all that it does, right? If you just take their code and don't look at it and just blindly run it on their data, these are the only guarantees you get. And I'm hopeful that even at this point in the talk, you can see that these are actually more limited than you might have thought that they were yesterday. And we're going to talk even more about how limited they are. But before we do that, just a brief thought experiment. So imagine an independent trusted system which accepts code, data, and some specification of an environment. It runs the code on the data. It saves and publishes and makes available for download the result and associates them with the code and the environment. And then it deletes the data because the data was private in some way, and so it can't be published. So, you know, identifiable human data, you can never just, like, post that on the internet. That's illegal and unethical, and you shouldn't be doing it, right? So if we think about a system like that, it turns out that that's actually going to give you virtually identical guarantees to what strictly reproducing the result yourself would have given you. And it does that without you actually having to be able to strictly reproduce the result. And so what this shows is that while reproducibility is very valuable and you should think about it and you should do it to the best of your ability, it's not actually necessary for the benefits that it provides. It is sufficient in some senses, not in others that we're going to get to in a second, but it's not necessary. There are actually other ways to get basically the same guarantees that you being able to reproduce the thing now would have given you. So I've talked a little bit. I just, you know, briefly alluded to the fact that not only is it not necessary, it's also not sufficient. So I'm going to show you why that is with a case study. So we're going to talk about a very, very influential, you know, very good paper that came out of some of the people from Bioconductor, Simon Anders and Wolfgang Huber, about this package DE-seq for differential expression analysis for gene expression. Okay, so now before I get to what I'm about to say, I want to preface this with none of the following is a criticism of the authors. They actually did everything right. This is a very good paper. It's a reproducible paper, and they did everything like to and actually even beyond the common best practices of the time, as far as I know. So, first steps first. This result is reproducible. So one of the things in this paper is that they have this fly data, you know, fly embryo data set, and they have two conditions. I don't remember what they are, but they're not actually important at all for what I'm going to say. And they find 864 genes that are differentially expressed across these two conditions. And if you take their code and run their code in the old version of DE-seq that they were releasing when they published the paper, you get 864 genes. So this is reproducible. That, we're done. But that's actually not the whole story. So if you take their code and you run it in a modern version of the same package, DE-seq, it actually doesn't work at all. Now, this isn't actually very surprising because, you know, 8 years is actually a pretty long time in the world of computing and APIs change. So this is like, okay, sort of, it happens. But actually, it's really, really not the whole story that this result is reproducible, because if you update the code to be used under the modern version of DE-seq and you run it on their data, you get a radically different result. You get less than half of the number of genes being called as differentially expressed under the modern version of the algorithm that you did under the original. So that's not great, right? That's not really what we want to see when we're trying to make our results reproducible. But again, the authors didn't do anything wrong. They did everything right. The result is reproducible, but you have this really weird, unsettling situation where it's reproducible and seems to potentially be wrong at the same time. Under their own algorithm's understanding of the system that it's interrogating. So,
well, one of the questions I would have is whether the display that you have presented there is sufficient. Are you sure that all the tuning parameters that underlie this?
They're default in both cases.
Default, right. Yeah. But there's a variance model in there that has been made more sophisticated, and it might be tunable to get exactly the same.
It might be, and you know, so there's a lot of nuance, and you know, a lot of biology, which frankly isn't my field. But the my point was that even I believe that that's true. I don't know if you'd be able to get exactly, but you could probably get closer, maybe, or maybe you know, maybe it was anti-conservative, and they've improved the algorithm substantially since then, right? Like both of those are possible, but. The expectation, the naive expectation that a user would have is that with default parameters, you would get more or less the same thing, right? So there's the same level of sophistication in terms of calling it then and now because you're using the default both times. And so, yeah, you can tune things to try to recreate that exact result, but the question then is that actually the right goal, right?
I completely agree with you. I think the idea of a result is one that has to be looked at critically.
Yeah.
In the sense that the result, which is a count of genes and a certain display, is not sufficient to know what was actually done.
Right.
You could say that, this is a default, put that there, but that actually constitutes a number of decisions.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
Reproduction has to be able to make use of all.
Yeah,
you
no.
You know that better than anybody else.
I agree with
this
that.
This particular problem, I'd like to criticize the presentation of the result in the sense that it isn't clear enough what's been done in order to make these things.
Sure, and that's fair. And you know, I haven't attempted to. You know, I haven't done sort of a meta fit to try to recreate that result, by sort of exploring the space of possible parameters to do that. I would still argue that that's probably not the right thing to do. Like, you should use parameters that are right for your problem, but you should use parameters that are right for your problem as the understanding goes now. And if that agrees with the old result, that's fantastic. And if it doesn't agree with the old result, that's really important. And that's the point that I'm trying to make here. And you know, just using the defaults was a cheap way to sort of get at that kind of idea. But yes, it's true that like you probably shouldn't just be using default parameters for whatever you're doing if it's at all complicated anyway. But that is what they did in their original paper. So, what I'm going to argue here is that, you know, because of these issues and the framing of trust instead of strict reproducibility, what I think what we actually need to think about is what I'm going to call generalized reproducibility. So I have this quote here, which, you know, I'm claiming it, and I think that other smart people have probably said it as well, although I've never seen it actually published in a paper anywhere, which is reproducibility is great, it's really important, and you should do it, but in itself it's neither necessary nor sufficient, it's neither as necessary nor as sufficient as many people who sort of think uncritically about reproducibility seem to think. And so I'm going to touch on, but not claim to solve necessarily, four different topics in what I'm calling generalized reproducibility. And these are comparability, currency, completeness, and then provenance. So, comparability. So, many people have probably seen this figure or something similar to it. The first time that I saw it, it was by Hadley Wickham, so that's the credit that I'm giving here. But it basically says that if you're a data scientist or a computational scientist, you're going to import your data probably after pre-processing, which isn't in this picture. And then you're going to transform it, and you're going to fit some sort of model to it to try to get some answers, and then you're going to visualize. And then you're going to sort of iterate on that until you're happy with where you are. Now, I'm not the biggest fan of this figure, and it's not because it's too old and the word tidy isn't in there. The reason that I'm not a fan of this figure is because it doesn't take into account that science is at its core collaborative. And so I don't think that, you know, stating the workflow of an individual person doing computing and saying thinking that you're done is the right thing. And what I actually think is closer to the situation that many scientists are going to find themselves is this figure here, where you've got each of these branches is, you can think of that as a different person or the same person with a sort of different analysis. So you've got a couple of different sets of data that may sort of get at different parts of the same problem, and then you've got a couple of different people doing analyses, and then what each of them are doing it can actually potentially inform what the collaborators are going to do, right? So you've got a lot more interdependency than that first figure that I showed you might lead you to suggest. So that's the backdrop which I'm going to about to talk about, right? And so if you're collaborating, then so what? You're collaborating, that's great, you know, it's going to make science better. It will, and it's a good idea, and you should do it. But imagine for a second you have two collaborators, and they have different data, and they have different versions of some tool. And then they get different answers for what's ostensibly the same question. Now, you can't actually figure out much of anything about why that is, because it could be the differences in the data, or it could be the differences in the tool that they're using. So what you actually need, if you want to do this, and you know, you can substitute version for, you know, tuning parameters that are equivalent to speak to Vince's point. But you need things to be comparable on the analysis level before you can actually start to talk about differences at the data level. Because otherwise it's confounded, like it's not actually an identifiable system. So that is what I call comparability. So if you have two people, whether they sit next to each other at the same desk or whether they're across the world and they're using tools, whether they're R or not R, you should think about, at the very least, you should think about whether those tools, the versions of the tools, are going to allow you to actually make these types of questions, both about differences and about combining. Like, if you want to combine these two results, then they better actually be comparable results again as well. So that's comparability. The next thing that we're going to talk about is something that I'm calling currency. As far as I know, there's not actually a coined term. I may have missed it, but I wasn't able to find a coined term for what I'm about to talk about, so I'm just going to call it currency, which is sort of evocative of what I'm going to talk about. So again, we're going to talk about this issue where, you know, whether it's because of, you know, tuning parameters or because of just fundamental differences in the algorithm, you've got these same data, different versions, different results issue. Now, the reason that this is important is because, in general, if due diligence has been done in terms of the parameters that you're using, modern tools are supposed to be better than the old tools, because if they're not, we would just still be using the old tools, right? So you actually sort of want to give more weight, you know, with the caveats that Vince mentioned, you actually want to give more weight to the modern version than you would even this reproducible result in the older version. And so that's what I mean by currency. Is it actually current? Like, can you consider the result current and valid under sort of current best practices? Now, it's not quite as cut and dry to that as that, and the reasons for that are the same reasons that the issue arises in the first place, which is that if you're in a fast-moving field and you're using bleeding-edge methods, well, bleeding-edge methods are called that for a reason, right? They're going to continue to be refined as and after you're using them, and they likely won't stay the state of the art. There will be some other bleeding-edge method. Like, I know that even the authors of the DE-Seq package suggest that you not use DE-Seq anymore. So there's DE-Seq 2, which I think even more radically changed the sort of default algorithm that does. And there are also a number of other differential expression tools in the bioconductor system that aren't even in the DEC lineage at all. And so you have this issue where if you're doing something that's the right thing to do when you do it, but that doesn't mean it's going to stay the right thing to do if you were then going to do the same analysis from scratch from 5 years from now, right? And what you really actually want is the answer that the correct analysis now would give you. And whether that is going to be the same as the answer that the correct analysis then gave you is something that I don't hear a lot of people talking about, thinking about, and I think that they should be. And in some cases, it may not even remain valid, right? Like, it may be that this was the best practice at the time, but the field has since noticed that there's some sort of fundamental problem with that approach, and they like an entirely different approach now. So there's no hard and fast rule. This is a judgment call, right? This is why science is hard. But generally speaking, modern versions would take precedence over older versions. So all other things being equal, I'd be more skeptical of genes that were identified in the old version but not the new version. As Vince pointed out, like in both cases, you probably shouldn't just be blindly using the defaults anyway. But assuming that this happens in a case where the parameters are basically equivalent, which I think it can, or in a case where the actual like best practice parameters are different. Like it can easily be the case that, yeah, you can get this parameter to behave like it used to, but the reason that that's not the default anymore is because that's not considered best practices anymore. So in any situation like that, you really actually want to give more weight to the new answer, which is supposedly better than the old one. And the same sort of goes for completely different methods. How much more precedence actually depends quite a bit on why this new tool exists and whether people actually agree that it's better or if it's just like someone had to publish so they could actually get their thesis done kind of situation, right? But all other things being equal, like if people don't do the type of analysis that led to that result now the same way that they did then, there's probably a reason for that. And if there is a reason for that, you need to take that into account when you're assessing that old, historical result. And that doesn't mean that the scholarship and the science that was done before right now is valueless. It just means that we're scientists. We actually have to do the science. We can't just blindly accept things that are true just because they were published, and considered true for a while, right? Like we have to convince ourselves that they're still true before we want to actually move forward doing that. So one note about this currency issue is that, as far as I know, it's very real in things like bioinformatics, deep learning, and other like bleeding edge, fast moving fields. It's not really a concern in a number of other fields. So like if your field just uses GLMs for things, GLMs aren't changing. GLMs are GLMs, and they've been that since like I was in primary school, right? So, just use your GLMs if those are the appropriate method, and then you don't even have to worry about this. But I know in bioinformatics, like, genetics, genomics stuff, and I suspect, but don't know in proteomics, you do actually have to worry some about this because there's new methods, and the new methods at least claim to be better than the old methods, and then there's new methods that, and different methods have different trade-offs. So, like, you actually have to assess these trade-offs. Yeah. I mean that it could be that the new defaults sort of assume a more modern data collection method. that I don't know the details. Like I'm not an expert in differential gene analysis, gene expression analysis, and I don't claim to be. But that's very possible. The answer is I don't know. I'm not enough of an expert in the actual method. I do know that there is a DE-Seq2 package, and the reason that there's a DE-Seq2 package is because they wanted to make even more sort of breaking changes to what they think is the right way than are reflected here, because it's by the same authors, right? And so they think that something else is a better idea now. And other people have had other allegedly better ideas. So like there's lots of ideas that the field seems to think are better. Like you wouldn't see any analysis now, I don't think, using the DE-Seq package. They would either use DE-Seq2 or one of these other methods, is my impression. And Vince may have a different opinion of that. But it could be that's right, and that like the defaults aren't actually right for the new data. I don't know. So the next situation that we're going to talk about is completeness. And so this is something that's near and dear to my heart because I actually wrote my thesis on this. And I'm also subsequently the only person who's ever read my thesis about this. I'm not claiming to have come up with the idea. So the idea is very old. So there's a paper that came out in 2001 by a guy named Rossini called Literate Statistical Practice. And one of the very first, like in the first paragraph or second paragraph in the intro, he makes this claim that the resulting document from your literate statistical practice should describe results and lessons learned as well as the means to reproduce all steps, even those not used in a concise reconstruction, which were taken in an analysis. So does anybody have any idea what he's talking about here? Why is he talking about steps that you don't actually need to create the result that you're attempting to publish? Any ideas? Well, that's okay. Well, clearly you didn't read my thesis. But what this actually means is that the things that people think about when they're talking about reproducibility are actually not the whole story. And they're not even the whole relevant story. They're not even the whole important story. And so the things that people think about are these things at the top here. So the result, a concise script that can create the result again, the data that you need to run on the concise script, and the compute, and if they're sort of pretty savvy about reproducibility, also the computing environment that was used. But there's a lot of other things that go into a result and inform the shape of the analysis that ultimately leads to the result that you actually sort of need to know about to really assess the decisions that were made during that analysis. So you've got the analysis decisions, you've got intermediate computations, which may be sort of confirmations that, you know, assumptions of various methods were valid, seemed to be borne out by the data. You've got sort of dead ends or things that you tried and then are like, oh, that didn't work, so that will inform what I'm gonna try next. And you've got just general exploratory work, which actually gives you an idea of the shape of the data, which then informs these parameters that you may want to use for these really complicated methods. And all of these are, in some sense, required to fully understand the research. And so that's why I have these words on the iceberg here. So if you just want to reproduce the result, you can do the thing that sort of savvy people do now, which is, you know, you have the result, you have your concise script, you have your data, and you have your environment, and you can recreate the result. But if you want to reproduce the research, if you want to understand the research at the level that you would probably want to if you're going to extend or really rely on it, or, you know, if you're in industry like I used to be, if you're going to make a, you know, multi-million dollar bet on this result being right, then you really want to be pretty sure, right? and you really kind of need this extra information before you can be really, really comfortable. And sometimes they won't give that to you, but and then you have to basically do it yourself, right? You have to sort of run through this and like think about other things that they might have tried and like try them yourself and do all this extra work. But you're never going to be sure that you did you tried the same things that they tried. So one of the things that you can think about when you're sort of publishing your result or even communicating your result to scientific collaborators, provided that they're the you know the same level of you know technical expertise as you, is communicating more fully like what you did, what you tried and it didn't work, what you tried and it kind of worked, but you thought that you could do better. All of these types of things that, that ultimately underlie the result under the surface. So that's completeness. It's basically just a statement of, you know, think about this maybe a little bit more than you are, both when you're assessing other people's work and when you're publishing your own. I don't have hard and fast answers of exactly how you should do this. I have some advice that I could give if people are interested after. But it's basically, yep.
So would you suggest that we use pre-registration reports for our analysis? Before starting, let's say, this is what I plan to do, I just plan to explore my data like this, I plan to apply these kind of analyses, and I do it, and if it doesn't work, it's fine, I can try something else, but at least I can explicit what my intentions are, and I'm not going to try left, right, and center until I get some.
Yeah, and so pre-registering analyses in at least some like major swaths of scientific computing and scientific analyses is a very good idea. And this is, I don't even think that this is the primary benefit of doing that, but I think it is, you do get that benefit. That's absolutely right. One of the things that I will say is that sometimes a lot of the time, depending on specific contexts and where in the pipeline you are, if we're talking about you know drug creation, exploratory analyses is actually the right thing to do, right? And so you can have, and that's sort of before you get to the stage where like you really want to pre-register things, right? So like you want some data that can sort of tell you about a problem, and then you want to be able to actually explore it, and then you get some new data to try to confirm the thing that your exploratory work suggested, right? Because you're sort of exploring all over the place, it sort of can't really statistically prove anything, but it can give you the hypotheses that you then confirm in a much more formal sort of pre-registered way. So it depends a little on sort of where in the process you are for that, but I do think that that pre-registration has a lot of value, and this will get you some of that. Absolutely. And it also, like, it will force you to report this one, right? So if like, if you pre-register something and then your published result uses a completely different analysis method, like, you actually have to, like, be upfront and say, yeah, we tried this other thing, it seemed like a good idea a priori, but it didn't work out. And here's the way that it didn't work out, and here's how that informed this new thing that we tried instead, right? And so in that sense, it will actually give you, it doesn't directly give you that, but it sort of indirectly forces that information to also be given, which is really valuable, I think. Any other questions about that? Yeah?
I'm going to have to bail out, but I did want to ask one question about this. There was, back in the days of S, a utility called Audit.
Yeah.
You're familiar with that. So you could generate a graph. Relationships between the function you call and the data that was
going to
be defined. Yep. Is there anything like that?
So, funny enough, one of my research packages essentially does this, called Tracker, with no E. There's a further reading section at the end of these slides, and I have a link to the paper, which has a link to that. So there are things that kind of do this. There's another thing called Drake, which is really more about defining upfront these sort of complicated graph-structured pipelines. But then, once you've defined it upfront, you actually do still have the graph after, so you can reason about that. So the there's a couple of different ways to do it. None of them are, I would say, are completely perfect. But yeah, so there, I'd say that that's an active research problem, how to get that in a sort of modern setting. Okay, so that is completeness. Next, we have provenance. So provenance, the Oxford Dictionary defines provenance as the source or origin of an object, its history and pedigree, or a record of its ultimate derivation and passage of an item through its various owners. And paraphrasing Freire et al., knowing a result's computational provenance allows us to A, gain insights into the reasoning used to create it, which is going to help us with this concept of statistical trust, verify acceptable procedures and methods were used, which is, helps us even more with the concept of statistical trust, and know how to at least attempt to reproduce it. So provenance is very valuable in this sense. The problem, of course, is that provenance is actually very hard in a sort of human-driven, by hand, non-pipelined analysis setting. And I do research in how to do that, but I'm not going to talk about that right now because it's not sort of something that I would suggest that you go and use right now for your production analyses. It's a research tool at this point. But ultimately, it's hard. It's easy if the system is contained and controlled. So like if you look, I don't have a slide for this, but if you look in neuroscience, a former colleague of mine named Nolan Nichols did a lot of work before he joined Genentech in his postdoc in capturing the provenance of neuroscience, neuroimaging results in like the, because there's, it's a constrained problem because there's basically three different end-to-end pipelines that you use to process that data. And so because they're sort of constrained end-to-end pipelines, and the pipeline is what controls what is run and when it's run and how it's run, you can just have the pipeline sort of record what it's doing, and then you have provenance and everything is great. When you're just running R code that you wrote arbitrarily in your own R session, like as Vince pointed out, this audit function isn't in R. It used to be in S. I don't even know if it's still in S, but it's definitely not in R, and I don't think it ever was. Ironically, you know, I talked to Luke Tierney once, and he said he always turned it off because it used to fill up his hard drive with this, like, you know, basic small text, because, you know, hard drives were like 64 kilobytes at that point. But in an unconstrained, non-pipeline world, provenance is pretty hard to capture, but it's also, as we can see, extremely valuable. And so we want to try to do it, and I'll talk a little bit about how to try to do it in the sort of practical section. But one thing to keep in mind, and the reason that this ends up being really valuable, is that a results provenance includes the provenance of the data that you use to generate it. And so it actually gives you a chain back because, you know, as every statistician and hopefully everyone who's ever even been in a statistics class knows, you know, garbage in, garbage out is the fundamental rule of the land, right? And so to trust a result, you also actually have to trust the input data that the result was generated from. And that's another thing that is not actually talked about quite as much as you might like. So these are the sort of high-level concepts that I don't think get enough play in terms of sort of how we should think about reproducibility. So are there any questions about that before I change gears just a little bit? Again, we're not gonna show any code, but I'm gonna talk about practice a little bit now. But first, any questions, any comments, thoughts? No? Okay, so reproducibility in practice. So as you know, someone who's lost to history first said, in theory there's no difference between theory and practice, but in practice there is. So this is actually somewhat important, and this is also the reason that the title of this talk is An Imperfect Guide to Imperfect Reproducibility, right? Because, so I just talked about ways that the actual concept of reproducibility is in some senses imperfect because it doesn't encompass like the larger context that and nuance that you want to think about. But the other reason that it's an imperfect guide to imperfect reproducibility is because reproducibility that you actually do is often going to be imperfect, but it's still going to be better than nothing, right? And so we're going to talk about easy things without a lot of overhead that you can do now. So we're going to start with a slightly out of order reproduction process. So if I am if I'm given a result and I want to know if it's true, I want to use it in my own work. The way that I go about it, in some sense, is backward. It's probably not going to surprise you because you just sat through the first half of this talk, but it may surprise some other people because you start at what I think some people might consider the end. So first, you have step zero. So do you have enough information to even try to reproduce this, right? And if you don't, then we're done. Like, no, you don't have the code, you can't get the code, you can't get the data. There's nothing that you're going to do. Like, just you can trust it blindly, or you can not trust it, and those are basically your options. Or you can spend all of the effort to try to recreate it from whole cloth, which is painful, right? If that's not the case, if you do have the code and the data, then the first thing that I would do is run it with modern software versions and with modern best practices. To get to Vince's good point here. And if it works in modern software versions and modern best practices and the results basically agree, then you're done. Like, you win at reproducibility, and you can then assess whether or not you have statistical trust for what they did, right? Because that's still important also. You don't have to worry about, these other things. If that's not the case, if it doesn't work at all in software versions, or if it doesn't reproduce, then you have to try to recreate the original environment. Often that is not an easy thing to do because people aren't actually that great about describing what their environment was. Even if they cite packages, they're not going to cite all of the packages in their library. They're not going to cite the dependencies, so you don't know what versions of those they had. If you're lucky, you'll have a paper, something like in the R context, something like this Anders and Huber paper, where they actually give you a full session info, and you can actually go off and try to recreate it. And I wrote a tool that would actually allow you to do that I'll talk about very briefly at the end. So you're either recreating or you're guessing and then recreating their original result. And then you try it, and if it works, then yay. It's strictly reproducible with all of the caveats that I just spent however long it was, talking to you about. And then you have to assess, okay, so did it just not work at all in modern versions? And if so, what the hell's going on there? And why did it do that? And if it did work in modern versions and the modern versions disagree, then you're sort of in this situation where you're like, okay, now what do I do? Like, I have these two things. One was hopefully best practices at the time. The other one is hopefully best practices now, and they don't agree. That sucks, right? What do we do? As I said before, there's not really, I can't give you a hard and fast algorithm that you can just plug things into and move on your way. Like, this is why science is hard. You have to think a little bit. But there's a couple of different options you have. One is just sort of move on with the modern versions. Say, like, okay, these are the best practices now. I'm just going to take these. I'm going to give these as much weight as I would have given the original ones if they had agreed, and just sort of not really pay that much attention to the original ones, which, of course, could radically change the claim that the paper was making and invalidate it or what have you. You can apply a number of other methods and see which sort of one gets more corroborated. This is probably a good idea if sort of there's a lot of competing tools, and all of the competing tools have caveats that have about the same amount of weight, which is the case in certain bioinformatics contexts at the very least. So then maybe you just sort of see, like, if you run another tool and it agrees more with the old version, then you're like, okay, maybe this isn't actually so bad. If that one actually also agrees with the new version, then you're like, okay, that's even more evidence that something has changed in the field between now and then. Now, of course, care needs to be taken here, right? Because if you do other methods, or even if you just run the modern software, as Vince pointed out, like you are in jeopardy of doing it wrong. And if you do it wrong, and then it disagrees with the old results, that doesn't actually mean the old results were bad. It means that your new results are bad, right? So you actually have to put enough effort into your new results that you trust them before you actually sort of make them go head to head with the old ones. And finally, the final option, which is the safest but probably not very satisfying to anyone, is just give up and move to a field that actually has established methods, and then you don't have to worry about this at all, right? Probably no one in this room is actually going to do that, but it would actually work, so I figured I'd put it in there. So that would actually be my method, more or less, if I actually needed to sit down and quote-unquote reproduce a result to assess whether I trusted it or not. And you can see that I don't start with running it in the original versions and seeing if it reproduces at all, because that's actually not the important question in my mind, right? The important question in my mind is, like, would scientists now think that this is the right thing, right? And so it's a different framing of the question. So, final part of, besides the wrap-up, the final part of my talk, I'm just going to sort of give you, these are more sort of like bullet points. I'm not going to go into much detail in any of them, but these are the types of things that I would suggest that you can do in order to improve the situation in terms of your own analysis code and what have you. So the first thing, obviously you're in an advanced R course, so you probably know this already, but I'm just going to say it anyway because it's that important. Script everything. Like, avoid manually doing anything if it's even the slightest bit possible to do so. And to illustrate the reason for that, I'm going to show you, a dramatization, if you will, of a scripted analysis and then a manual analysis. So here's the scripted analysis. So we've got a chicken crossing the road here. And if I asked you to tell me how the chicken crossed the road, I think you'll probably be able to do it, right? And then we have our manual analysis here. And if I ask you to tell me how many licks it took, unless you're the owl, you probably don't know because no one recorded anything and it's not scripted. So that's not great, right? So this is a hopefully amusing way of illustrating and really hammering home the difference between scripting things and not scripting things, right? Even if you did it right, how could I know if you did it right if you did it manually, right? Like, it's not that I don't trust you, it's that I don't trust anyone, right? And I want to see it, and I can't because it was manual. Now, there are situations, there are tools, like, I don't have a slide on this, so I'm just going to say it for the record here. But so there are tools like OpenRefine, which will allow you to do similar things to some of the types of things you might want to do in Excel, but actually will give you a rerunnable audit trail of steps that were taken in the system. And so that type of manual but with replayable recorded steps is okay. I would still, prefer not. Because those steps aren't actually going to be super fun to like consume and reason about, but at least they're there. So in that case, it can be okay, but like, just being in Excel and being like, oh, that's a 4, but I really think it should be a 5, like, don't do that. That's very bad. So versions and naming and file naming, the instructor talked about this a little bit in the very first session of this course. But I'm just going to reiterate it again because A, I had already put the slides in, and B, because it's important. This is such a common problem that I was able to find 2 new comments about why this is a bad idea, in addition to the one that she showed you a couple of days ago. And what this ultimately boils down to is file names are not the right place to put metadata. And I will say that again because it's really important. File names are not the right place to put metadata. They're just not. And especially they're not the right place to put really vague metadata that's not useful anyway. Like, this one here. It's like, untitled 243 important. Like, okay, like, that's great. I'm glad that your data is important. But I don't have any idea what's in there. or how it's different from Untitled 2.2.doc, right? Like, and the other thing down here, we've got this, you know, this series of, you know, ostensibly different versions of the same DAT file as the person. You probably, I don't know if you can read that text or not, but the basic gist is that the analyst is getting increasingly upset as, you know, time goes on and the person has to generate, keep generating new versions of the data. But each new version of the data is in a new separate file. And then you have to remember to update your script to read in the new version of the file rather than the old version of the file. And you probably won't because you're a person and not a computer. So don't do that. So here's a little bit even more. So avoid encoding metadata solely in file names. You can put it there if you want to put it there, but never only put it there. Okay? So versions. Don't put versions in there at all. But for other things, like, you know, so we have this my data, you know, BRAF mutants only. That should not be the only place that it says that these are BRAF mutants. Okay? Like, that should be in the actual data that I read in when I read in this file. And if it's not, you have very serious problems. The same goes for timestamping things, right? If you just say, okay, this is the data from Tuesday, and then you don't have a date anywhere, like, as a column in the table, then this is bad, and you don't want to do this. Because someday, you're going to want to combine the data from Tuesday with the data from Wednesday and be able to tell the difference in which observations were from Tuesday and which ones were from Wednesday. And you can't do that if you don't actually put that in the data. So don't do this. And I say don't do this because I have seen this done, right? Like, this is something that people do. Don't be those people, okay? Also, you know, to just reiterate the course that the beginning session at the beginning of this course, just use version control. Like, just do it. Like, there's no reason that you shouldn't be doing it. There's no good reasons that you shouldn't be doing it. And yeah, just do that. If you've never used it before, it may be a little bit scary, but it's worth it. And you will eventually really regret it if you don't. It may not be immediate, but it will happen. So just use version control. And then different versions of the same file will have the same name, but you'll still be able to tell them apart because they'll be different versions, and then everything is great. Okay? So that's that. So literate analyses, I'm going to talk just a little bit about the sort of practicalities of this. Not a ton. This is something that was covered a little bit, quite a bit in the beginning. But just use R Markdown, you know, Knitter or Sweave or what have you. One of these literate document systems. They're great. The reason that they're great is that they get rid of you ever needing to cut and paste your results anywhere. And you should never cut and paste your results anywhere. It should always be a computer that puts your results where the results should go. Because computers don't make mistakes, and you do. And I do. And everyone does. That's a person. So just avoid that. Just don't do it. The point of literate statistical analyses, other than the completeness thing which I talked about before, is just not ever allowing that to happen, right? So it runs the code and it immediately puts the result of the code directly in the document without talking to you or asking you or doing anything else in between those two steps. And that means that you get trust in reporting for free in cases that aren't actual outright fraud, right? So, like, you could go in and edit the tech document or the HTML, like, if you actually wanted to be fraudulent. But if you're not doing that, then you know that the version of the code and the version of the result, they match up, and that they're correct. So that is good, and you should do that. Now, something that a lot of people like are notebooks. So if you want to use Jupyter notebooks or R Markdown notebooks, you need to immediately go watch or read Joel Gruss's amazing talk about why you shouldn't do that, essentially. So go ahead and I'll wait. I'm kidding because it's like an hour long, but you really, really should actually watch it. He makes a lot of points that I would have made if I were giving that talk. And he's right. So watch it, take what he says to heart. Some of it will be less important to you because it's more about sort of teaching, but like the beginning bit is really, really important and you really, really should watch it. So if you still want to use notebooks after watching that, A, maybe go watch it again because it doesn't seem like you got it the first time, but B, here are three rules that that you need to follow if you're still going to use notebooks for whatever reason. So first, always run them start to finish before you publish, okay? Second, never fully trust output in a notebook that wasn't run start to finish. You may be seeing a pattern here. Third, always run them start to finish before you publish. Always, no matter what. I don't care if it takes a while. You need to do it. And the reason for this is because, well, I mean, it's because of all the things that are, the first 30 minutes of Joel's talk. But very basically, it's very easy to get into a situation where the execution of the notebook was actually nonlinear, so you have a bunch of state, and the code actually doesn't necessarily. So if you just run the code again, you'd actually get a different answer. You don't know what's going on, and it's very bad, and you don't want that. So you can use them. They're convenient in some senses for authoring things, but you really need to just treat it like an R markdown file or an RNW file. Just run it start to finish before you actually consider yourself done. That's very important. Okay? So next is sharing. So this is roughly speaking, the current state of sharing materials in publications. So just to justify that with some actual research. So about 44, so less than 50% of papers that were published in Science, since it became the explicit policy of Science that you have to share code and data, actually shared code and data. Okay, so less than half. This is not great, right? You can flip a coin and guess and do better than whether or not you're gonna get the code and the data from a Science article. So that's bad. And the reason for that are there are lots of them, and you can go read that. This is a really good paper. You can go read this paper. You should go read all of Victoria Stodden's papers if you care about reproducibility, because she's like the preeminent person in the field, basically, or one of them. But this one particularly, it talks about how and why people don't do what they're supposed to do and they should be doing. But the bottom line is that they don't. Again, don't be one of those people. You should share your code. And so Vince talked about needing to be egoless. And that's one side of the story, and it's an important side to the story. But there's another side to the story, which may hopefully give you some comfort if you're not egoless, like everyone who isn't a Zen master, essentially, which is people don't care how ugly your code is. We have better things to do than criticize your code. If it's right, good. It's right. That's it. We're done. If it's wrong, then I do care, but that's because it's wrong, right? So if it's wrong, your readers deserve to know, and you deserve to know, because you just published something that wasn't right. And if it's right, your readers don't care that it's not commented and that it's ugly and all that, all the things that you're worried about. Nobody, you're not that important to the rest of us, okay? Like, your code, we just want to know that it's right. That's all. And that should be all that you care about for other people's code too, right? Like, so don't be a jerk about it. Don't be a jerk if they're right, and don't be a jerk if they're wrong, because people are human. But just share your code, right? Everything is better if you share your code. It's scary, and you don't want to, but do it anyway. Your results will benefit. And so, like, another thing, in terms of, like, so I've talked to people. Vince alluded to this very early. I've talked to Robert Gentleman. He says the same thing, which is like the only way to really make your code good is to get it out there and get people running it, right? Because your code will have bugs in it. My code has bugs in it. Everyone's code occasionally has bugs in it. This is how coding works. So you'll either hoard your code away and just have a bug and continue to have a bug. So congratulations on that. Or you can let people see, and usually it will be fine because most of your code, most of the time, doesn't have bugs. But when it does, this will help you find them and actually make your analyses better and make your results right, which is better than them being wrong. So just share your code. It's a good idea. Share your data if you can. Now, again, sometimes you can't. If it's human data, you probably can't. But if it's fly embryo data, I don't really care about the privacy of fly embryos, so just share your data, okay? Now, this is a little bit tricky, and anyone who doesn't acknowledge that it's at least a little bit tricky is probably being at least a little bit disingenuous, and the reason for that is because collecting data is hard and time-consuming and takes a lot of effort, and particularly if you're like really early in your career, you really want to get the benefit of all that effort and establish yourself as an expert. So it can be a little bit tricky. However, if your answer to that trickiness is, I'm just never going to share my data, or I will share it once it's not useful to anyone else, or once, you know, 10 years from now when I've published like 50 papers and, you know, done everything I could possibly think of, that makes you the bad guy, right? So share it, and share it pretty quickly, right? Like if you already have an idea for another paper, maybe you could, and like it's going to be done, like maybe you get a little bit of leeway to try to take that that next step. But you really be reasonable, right? Like as long as your data isn't published, your first paper that you got out that you're so happy about, other people are just going to look at that as a paper without any data, and they're going to treat it accordingly, right? Which is probably not how you want your result treated. So share your data as soon as you can, and be honest with yourself and others about how soon that is, right? Even though it's a little bit scary. Okay? So basically, what you should do is you should publish science as if you personally will need to understand, evaluate, and extend your result in 5 years working only from the materials that you published, because you have mysteriously lost all of your personal versions in some sort of fire, right? If you can't do that, none of the rest of us can do it either, which means that your result has all of the problems that we've been talking about, right? And if you can do that, then we're good, right? Like, you still have to worry about currency and completeness a little bit, but like, you're in a really good shape if you do this. So this is what you should be trying to do, okay? That should be the goal. And I picked 5 years because you probably don't actually remember exactly what you did 5 years later, right? So you actually have to figure it out from what you said and what your code says and what your data says and the provenance information that you have about your data and all of that. So environment recreation. I just spent like quite a bit of time explaining to you why I don't think that this is the be-all end all of reproducibility, or rather, if it is the be-all end of all of reproducibility, then reproducibility itself is not the be-all end all of whether you should trust results or not. But it's still actually really important, and I don't want to lose that while we're sort of talking high concept. So you should actually know how to make sure that your environment is recreatable and how to recreate other people's environments. This is also, again, crucial for multi-analyst collaboration. So you may not. So you can think about reproduction either by yourself or by someone else as a collaboration across time. But you also do collaborations across people and across space at the same time. And those need to have the same environment, or at least compatible environments as well. And they, you know, don't have all of these caveats that I was just talking about, because it's actually just the right way to do things. So you need to try to be able to do this. So for recreating or distributing our package libraries, so if you're in the R Bioconductor context, there's a number of different tools that you can use. So I wrote Switcher, and I wrote Switcher specifically to do this, so I'd like to think that it's a pretty good way of doing it. So Switcher will allow you to install arbitrary old versions of packages, and it will also parse in session info output. So that's how I actually found out that, you know, the 10-year-old, or at the time it was 6 years old, but the still 6-year-old paper by Anders and Huber, the result actually was reproducible in the strict sense. I actually, like, there weren't any tools that would allow you to actually take the session info, which they provided, and actually make it into something that's actually useful. So that is why Switcher was written. So you can, I'll leave this an exercise to the reader. You know, go get Switcher. It's on CRAN. You can read the paper. There's a paper about it and how it works and why I wrote it also. And find a session info somewhere and try to recreate someone's environment. Another tool that does this, but instead of retroactively, it does it proactively if action is taken by the analyst itself, is PackRat. This is an RStudio product. And this basically bundles up the exact the tarballs of the exact versions of the packages that you're using in your project, so that you can like carry it around and send it to other people and send it to other machines and all that kind of thing. So that's great. A third thing, which came out a little bit after both Switcher and PackRat, which were roughly contemporaneous, they happened roughly at the same time. MRAN came a little bit later, but what MRAN is so Microsoft provides dated snapshots of the CRAN repository. So if you need packages as exactly as they were on, you know, May 5th of 2018, you can go to the May 5th, 2018 CRAN snapshot in MRAN and be like, I'm just install your packages from that repository, and you'll get the exact old versions that you asked for, right? So a couple of caveats on that. A, it does not include Bioconductor, which is a bummer, but there you go. B, because it's a more modern project, it's really only useful for pretty modern results because they started snapshotting. They didn't retroactively create snapshots, you know, from before they started the project. So anything that's a little bit older is not going to work out, but you can actually just declare that in your code for things you're doing now, and then other people would be able to use this tool. So that's another completely different approach. So these basically represent three completely different approaches to trying to solve this problem for our analyses with our packages specifically. None of these do anything for operating system differences or differences in external tools that you're linking against or anything like that. So there's that. So Docker for reproducibility, a lot of people think that Docker is really cool. I think that Docker is really cool too, but for slightly different reasons than a lot of other people. A lot of people think it's a really good idea for reproducibility. And these are smart people, and they're good to listen to also. And there's some tools that make it easy. So there's the Rocker project, which is by Carl Bodiger and Dirk Edebuttal. And that basically puts R and a few other things into Docker images, so then you can use those as base images and build up an image that's exactly what you were using when you were doing your analysis. And then you can just give other people that image, and then they can run the analysis in the exact same thing that you do. And if you actually do your analyses in these Rocker containers, then it will literally be in exactly the same environment because they'll be in the same Docker container as you are. So Bioconductor has something similar. They're not Docker images. They're AMIs for use on Amazon Cloud web services. There's something there. And they provide versioned AMIs for a number of different versions of Bioconductor. And because Bioconductor is versioned as a platform, that basically gets you a more or less, I don't know what they do exactly about patch versions, but a more or less cohesive, constant version of Bioconductor packages that you can then use on Amazon if you have an account and, you know, are willing to pay for the compute there. Yep. So a .rdata file does not contain your packages at all. It just contains your code. A .rdata file, so it depends a little bit on what you're talking about. So if you're talking about the workspace that's been saved out as you're working, you should turn that off. You shouldn't have that on in the first place. And the reason for that is because if you do, suddenly R has state, and that is bad, right? Because it has state. What you're doing now depends on what you did a week ago that you don't even remember, but are remember is because you told it to. So you should turn saving your workspace off and just never do that. There's a switch in RStudio. I couldn't tell you where to find it because I don't use RStudio, but don't do that. But if you're talking about, like, you call save and you save a result or you save some set of results into a serialized file, that's a good thing to do for various reasons, but that doesn't include the environment at all. So it includes the names of the packages so that if you try to load the thing, load the packages that you have loaded that, for example, have your S4 classes that these objects are in them, but it doesn't encode or ensure version information in any way. So that's not actually going to solve this problem at all. That's a problem of transporting your result, not the environment that your result was created in. Any other questions? Okay, so there's that. This probably isn't going to come as a surprise to you, but I'm not the biggest fan of using Docker for reproducibility for the reasons that I just spent an hour talking to you about. The issue with Docker is that, so A, if everyone uses Docker, then every result is in and probably at least subtly different environment, which means that ensuring comparability is going to be really hard because you have your Docker container that you made your results in, and they have their Docker container that they made their results in, and they're not the same. You have to then reason about how they're not the same. There aren't really any tools to do that. And then you have to figure out if they're close enough to the same and do all of this other thing. And I don't think that, again, because of, like, if you recall the version of, you know, my backwards process of assessing reproducibility of a result, like, that's the last step. Like, the last resort is attempting to do it in exactly the same environment that the original analyst did. Now, I will say that there's a very big caveat. I'm talking about R analyses, right? I'm not talking about sort of weird, like, academic software that's, like, hyper difficult to install, and, you know, if you do install it and you're not the person who wrote it, it's probably broken and all of these things, right? Like, then just use the Docker that they hopefully would give you, right? But if you're in R, right, or if you're in, you know, Python or what have you, the reason I don't like Docker is because it puts the cart before what I think the horse should be. And so you can assess whether you agree with me on that or not. I hope that I've convinced you, but that's up to you as a scientist. There are lots of people who use Docker for reproducibility, both for their own results and to consume results that have been published that way, and are very happy about that. And you can go read what they have to think about it too. But I think that, you know, even if someone gave me a Docker container, I would still try to run it outside of the Docker container first, because that gives me more information. So with all of that said, there is a really cool project that you can look at called My Binder. So what this does is it allows you to put your code on GitHub, and then it will make your code runnable by other people. You have to have code that either the repo also has the data in it, or the code's able to pull the data from somewhere. And it uses Docker for this. If you are going to do this, and this comes straight from their docs, be careful, because it will create a new Docker image for every commit. Now, Docker images by default are going to install the latest version of whatever software you asked for. So that actually won't be doing what you thought that it was doing. It will be doing something closer to what I would want you to do, but you should be aware of that, right? So either do that on purpose because you think that's the right thing, or you actually have to specify your dependencies in such a way that the Docker is actually created with specific versions of the things that you're asking for, which is doable, but, you know, takes extra work and you have to be careful about that. But MyBinder is a very cool project. You should check it out. You should consider putting your code up there as a way of publishing it. So I don't have any idea what time it is. All right, so I will try to, we're almost done. I'll quickly go through the rest of this. So provenance light, as I mentioned before, provenance is very hard to do in an unconstrained system, but you should try. So you should aspire to know where your data came from, because if you don't know where your data came from, honestly, you're not a very good scientist, right? Like, you should know. And if you do know, you should tell other people where it came from, right? So whatever you know about where your data came from, put that in your publications. Like, put it in your publications in the most useful form that you can, right? Even if it's imperfect, right? So some is better than none. And that's going to be true of everything that I just said, right? Like, doing some of this is better than doing none of this, and doing all of this, I would argue, is doing better than some of it. And even doing all of this won't actually get you all the way to the theoretical ideal, because this is a guide to imperfect reproducibility that's actually achievable while you're doing your normal work. So publishing your results, include your code and very detailed explanations of every manual step, data if you can, provenance if you have it, and version environment information, because as we just talked about, it is still important even though it's not the first step. Consider open access if you can. It's unfortunately not as simple an issue as we would like, because most of the really high impact journals aren't open access, which is a bummer when you're trying to make a name for yourself as an early researcher and you want to be open access, but you also want to like get a job. And I can't really help you with that because I don't run any of these journals. But when you can, when you're in a position where it will not hurt you to be on open access, then you definitely should. And the reason for that is, how could a result possibly be useful if people can't even get it in the first place, right? Answer being, obviously, it can't. So that was a lot. I know that was a lot. I know that there was some things that you probably didn't expect to hear in a reproducibility talk in here. But I hope that I've made you think. And the way that I figure it, right, if you give someone a fish, you fed them for a day. If you teach them to fish, then you fed them for their whole life. But if you teach a bunch of people how fishing works and what fishing fundamentally is, then someday one of them is actually going to improve how everyone fishes. So that was the goal here. Hopefully that will happen. But if not, hopefully you got some useful tips in terms of your own work. So some takeaways. This is always true. This is very true of like analysis method choices as well, which I don't have time to get into too much. But like, think about what you actually want. What you actually want may not be what you think you want on first blush. So do what's going to give you the thing that you actually want, not the thing that seems like it might give you what you want. And that's for you and for your readers. Reproducibility is not valueless, but it is more valuable when viewed within a larger, more nuanced context, and I think most people do. Share your code and data, and don't be assholes to other people who do the same. You would hope that this is obvious, but empirically it's not. And publish science that you'd be able to trust if it came from a lab that you don't recognize. With that, that's the end. So thank you for listening, and I will take any questions. So non-static output is a whole another can of worms that I didn't have time to get into in this talk at all. Like, I considered putting like reproducibility with like guidelines with shiny thing in, but like that's another hour-long talk probably. But
I just meant like a new version of the underlying algorithm release, and so that triggers.
So I think it's definitely technically possible. I was actually working on something similar to that when I was at Genentech. It was very early stages, and we didn't get to that, but we were laying the groundwork that would have allowed us to do that. I'm not at Genentech anymore, so I'm not currently still working on that. But I think, so something like my binder, like this thing that I just described, with just a little bit of a paradigm shift in how you actually think about what's happening, could very easily become something like that. So there are no real technical barriers to trying to do that. It's just that most people don't think about wanting to do that. So I think that it could. Now there's some costs there, right? Because it's like, okay, so I have this paper I published 5 years ago, and like it's now broken. Like, do I actually want to go spend a bunch of my time now, like on a paper that I already got basically all the benefit I'm ever going to get from it in terms of my career, right? Like that's a large cost, and so you could just mark it as not reproducible anymore, take with a grain of salt and move on. You know, there are good things and bad things about that, right? Like, as soon as you mark things like that, people will be like, no, it's wrong. This is actually false now, which isn't actually what it means, right? But communicating that nuance would be really hard. And then maintenance is really hard, right? And really costly. And so maintaining scientific results would basically make them software. With all of the costs of maintaining software that go with that. And as a practical matter, I don't think academics are able or willing to really do that. But I do think that it's I think it's a good idea, and I think that we may get there eventually, but like there will be a lot of angst and cultural change that surrounds that. But I agree that would be really nice. Because then you know, right? Like one way or the other. And then only one thing has to try to recreate it instead of, okay, you know, everyone in this room cares about the result. Now everyone in the room, like, go try to reproduce it. It's like if you have a system that does that for you and at least part of the way there, then it happens once instead of many times. And you know, despite what it may seem to many people, electricity and compute are not free. So they cost money and they have consequences so to using lots of them. So I think that would be really good. And I think it's possible. I don't know of any efforts other than the one that I was doing that's not happening anymore to actively move towards that right now though. Any other questions?
Yep. So this all sounds like a lot of work.
Yeah.
So if I want to do something good, but I don't have a finite amount of time. What do you recommend as practical steps?
So the practical steps are A, you know, make sure that you do the best science that you do first off, right? Because that if you don't, then once you get to the statistical trust thing, people are going to be like, no, that was a dumb idea. I don't what you did. Use things like R Markdown Knitter, so like there's literate documents that automatically insert the results, so like you're not cutting and pasting things wherever possible. I know of a few papers that were actually written in that whole cloth. Most journals don't really want that because it's not as pretty, but you know, fight for that and try to do that when you can. Or at the very least, maybe have an RMD version of the analysis that's in the supplementary material, which is actually what Huber and Anders did for that paper back then. Always include in whatever the equivalent of the session info for your R session, so that you know we at least know what's happening and can try to get back, and then Switcher can help you do that. Or use Docker if you like Docker to do that. And the other big one is include as many things as you can. Include negative results and what they told you in your supplemental materials. Like you already did them anyway, right? Like you have them. Just put them in there. So those things, like just all of the information that you actually have. The same for provenance, right? Like you know some information about where the data came from. Just put that information in the supplementary materials of your publication, right? Like, it's better if you can get more, but you know, in terms of the like low effort, you know, best practices, just whatever you have is good, right? And like a lot of the big data, you know, sources these days actually do have provenance that if you know what you're looking for, you can actually just download the provenance that they actually take a great deal of care in keeping about the data, and then just slap that in there. So yeah, so those types of things are the really low effort stuff, right? You know, record what environment you were using, you know, use these literate documents, dynamic documents, and don't only publish the concise version. You know, publish the things that you tried and a brief discussion of, like, very brief even, of how and why they didn't work and how that informed. And I think that'll get you a lot of the way there by itself. Any other questions? All right, well, then I think we will call it a day. Thanks for staying a little bit over. And enjoy the rest of the Institute.